Warning, the following content may contain elements that are not suitable for some audiences. Viewer discretion is advised. Welcome back to the Bard's Playhouse Presents Tales from Shadow Valley, Season 4, Episode 19, 100th Episode Spectacular! Boo, 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 boo. Thank you so much for joining us. Now let's bring in our wonderful cast. We have Eldritch as Khan, the bloody Rizzolo.
Always great to be here. Will Khan be saved from the horrors of mathematics?
Shane as Umbromancer Zavid.
I'm in a different locale! Oh, spooky!
Elliot as Reese Guiltleaf, the Heart Seeker.
I feel flat today.
And Ash as Queen Dani Arion.
I may have shrunk Arwen accidentally.
Oh. Oh, so adorable. As always, I am Lumby Bronzearm, will be your DM for today. Last time, Lux Et Umbra had made their way deeper into the Lost Silhouette, Zavid having spotted Khan's childhood friend Wasilka the Fantabulous strapped to a table, sprang into action. Using shadowy transposition magics, Zavid freed Wasilka from her bonds and threw Khan into the fray. Unfortunately, their timing was too late, as Wasilka had been transformed into an undead ghast by the Axiomite Grave Knights who had kidnapped her just hours prior. Dispatching the torturers proved a trivial task for Lux Et Umbra, especially with their new allies, Alzum and Tal'Darris, the First Emperor. Once the adrenaline had subsided, Khan began to weep for Wasilka. However, the ever-cheerful halfling gave her a hug and words of encouragement from across the room. Shocking Lux Et Umbra, and even Wasilka herself, a tiny voice came from Wasilka's puppet, Charlie. Zavid was quick to realize that the Grave Knights had not completed their conversion of Wasilka. Her soul had been split, half placed within Charlie, half remained. As Khan and Wasilka the Ghast-tastic reassured one another, Zavid noticed a hallucinatory wall which had been previously blocked by Arwen's massive flaming body. Ever the prankster, Reese commanded the power of purple orcs to become invisible and follow behind Zavid. Behind a velvet curtain sat a large, strange, aberrant creature covered in hundreds of eyes, Hamalkai, the Hyakumei. Second in command of the Lost Silhouette, Hamalkai had been spying on Lux Et Umbra since the moment they had arrived in Axis. Knowing that Nyarlathotep had control over Klokosik the Naga, Zavid acted quickly by destroying the magical mental hold upon Hamalkai. Though confused at first, Hamalkai quickly regained her faculties and handed over dire information. It seems that the secret shade has summoned forth the Herald of Norgorber, the Stabbing Beast, for reasons unknown to Hamalkai. Further in still, behind another illusory wall, Lux Et Umbra found a comfortable break room. Hallucinatory masonry abounds as Zavid squeezed himself into a tight corridor leading to the private chamber of the secret shade itself. Upon a table were not only stacks of paper detailing the information gathered by Hamalkai's spying eyes, but also a contract. Written in ever-burning blood, the secret shade has agreed to assassinate petitioners Eopal and Imaro and First Emperor Tal'Darris in exchange for information. The right hand of Norgorber, the secret shade was his rival in life. When Norgorber passed the test of the Starstone and ascended to godhood, he raised up his rival, but erased all traces of who the Secret Shade was. As such, the Secret Shade struck a deal with Shax, Demon Lord of Murder. Three lives for information on one. It is clear the Shade does not understand the potential cosmic repercussions of not allowing petitioners Eopal to vote on Axis military mobilization, but perhaps Lux Et Umbra could convince it they are more capable than Shax. As he is wont to do, Reese became bored of the theologic chit-chat and snuck away. In a further room, he found a large winged creature strapped to a gurney, surrounded by bizarre, ill-formed creatures holding a book. The walls covered in advanced mathematics he couldn't understand, Reese waved Khan over. Listening for but a moment, and focusing her genius, the hyper-advanced, chaotic mathematics, not hailing from this reality, caused incredible mental pain in the brilliant rat. Hopefully, this won't be on the final.
I love that.
That is where we are coming in today. Once again, everyone, thank you so much for 100 episodes. Congratulations to all of us. I never thought we would make it this far. I know, right? I was supposed to just be a replacement for a DM who left like a different server. Ash, wasn't it called something else? Weren't we called like
Are you sure you want to do that?
Yeah, that was it. But anyway, the show survived despite all odds.
The show endures.
So,
I am the show.
So once again, we come in the infinite floating void, and the haremat of Baba Yaga the Overlady each of these dozen basketball court-sized cards with familiar PCs sit in front of you. Baba Yaga looms over the horizon, her raven locks floating about her. She looks down and says, "Welcome back, players. I think 4 weeks in a row now. Wonderful. And congratulations again on 100 sessions. And as we said last time, being as you're the only one from session one, Eldritch, you have the honor today. Step forward, please."
Little old me, I get to pick on the 100th session.
All yours.
I jog past the cards. I'm out of breath. Oh, Baba Yaga!
She's running away.
That's because I was trying to say real quick. Eli has, Lumby has the overlady as the main thing for the camera to follow, not Eldridge.
Oh, whoops.
Yeah, so I'm usually used to having the person who's,
Here, I can do this.
Thank you.
Yes, there we go. Problem solved.
I think. Hold on. It's still saying the green one is... Okay, Eldridge is there. It's so weird. It's not this show without tech issues.
No, it wouldn't be... We couldn't get through our 100th episode without tech problems.
Yeah.
It's fine.
I can remove her from the board if we need be.
Wait, hold on.
Oh my god, look at the cat.
I got it. Okay. I moved L on my own.
Okay.
I got this. Okay, so fabulous. We're now in L's perspective.
Woo! Yes.
There we go. Thank you, Fantasy Grounds, being weirdo.
Thanks, everyone, for your patience.
Anyway,
all right. You know, we've been on a real hot streak, I would say, of choosing each other's current player characters. So I'm going with Danny.
Yes!
I was right.
I didn't want to be conceited and be like, of course she's going to pick me.
I feel that because that's how I felt with Shane picking Reese.
Yep, Reese, you can take it. All right, Elliot, you can take a hero point for Reese. Ash, I am sending this to you. And Ash, I'll tell you, if you do it precisely the way I wrote it, I'll give you a hero point as well. Or you can just read it. Your choice.
Okay.
But give me a second to get there. But yes, so Baba Yaga says, picking another one of your fellows today, eh? Wonderful. Queen Daniela Arion. Wonderful choice. She reaches down her massive hand and, whoops, that's the wrong link, sorry.
Grabs Eldritch token and squeezes!
And she flips over the card, and standing before you is Danny, a beautiful half-elf queen with a crown that is of gold and silver that is crafted into to look like leaves, like an emperor of Rome. Fine dress and lilac eyes stands before you.
Hi, Con.
No, you were. I thought you were.
Well, thank you for choosing me. I have a little something for you. And so I'll learn a spell, or maybe two or three. I'll add a few new friends to my menagerie. I'll read some smut, pray to Shalin, and basically just wondering when will I get to sin. Wind played, PC cast banishment as a 9th level spell, sending the targets to a harmless demiplane in the form of Danny's Tower. No saving throw for creatures below demigod status.
Oh, fuck. Ooh. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's dope.
Ooh. It's that could be very helpful in the future.
Yeah.
When will my sin begin?
I'm dropping that in your inventory now, Con. The Danny Arion Queen of Druma card. So, yes, you can now use that to, at any point, cast Banishment with no saving throw to the enemy as long as they are not at least a demigod. So I'll tell you that, like, Shax would be on that level, but anything weaker than about Shax would be no saving throw, banished.
Yeah.
Nice.
But with that,
Danny... So you're telling me you can't tell Rovagug to go to your room?
Exactly. That is. I have put a little bit of a, a limit.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, but with that, Daniela Arion, wow, fades into a blue transparent hologram, and gives the queen wave, and Baba Yaga says, "Wow, wonderful! Most of Lux Et Umbra down. Looks like only the Conrad solo card remains. Perhaps Elliot will choose it." But let us see. Next time, on our 101th episode, that is going to be Elliot. Oh, perhaps we could finish off Lux Et Umbra. Ta for now. And Baba Yaga fades once more into the void. And this is where we come in proper today. If you have music, turn it on. We have come in.
We should get some battle music going on. Yes, not this ethereal, pretty noise.
Ethereal, pretty stuff. We need some combat music. But taking all of you off of the tracker from the Baba Yaga map, first up to react is Hamal Kai. Hearing Khan scream out in pain from this psychic damage, realizing what's going on, she says, "Oh no! The amalgamites! Don't let them out!" And she runs in 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 40, because she's a monk. And seeing them, is that two or one? Oh, good. And she's going to use a second action to get over here and use a fist attack to punch these. Critical.
Ooh. Girl boss.
Yeah, it was a natural 19. So Hamal Kai does 68 damage to this thing. It absorbs a little bit, but after the hit, she is going to use Scatterbrain Palm. The creature hit by the Hamal Kai's first fist strike must attempt a will save or become stunned, because Hamal Kai is essentially a monk. So that is Amalgamite 3. Where is it? 3. That's a will save. 41, that's pretty high. 43, so it passes. But that is still stunned 1. So, this guy is going to miss an action on his next turn, which brings it to Khan. You are up.
Alright, she staggers a bit, clutching her head, like, ears flat against the rest of her fur, just like, oh! So I think she's gonna, she remembers where the enemies are, so she's trying to not look at the math on the walls. She's trying to, you know, okay, I need to go into fight mode. I can't go into think mode. Think mode bad.
Think mode bad.
So movement action. And we're not really flanking with that guy, but it would be...
you are, because Hamal Kai's large.
Oh! Cool.
Yep, I have given it off guard.
Nice. All right. And then, big shocker to all the people at home, but Khan is going to stab this guy.
Heck yeah.
I know, it's so unlike her.
Plus, even if it weren't flanking with Hamal Kai, you're going before it in order, so you would be, it's flat-footed to you regardless.
That's so true!
Ooh, nat one!
I'm gonna leave that be. It's a result of the psychic damage. She's not cool.
You do get your free Khan's bladed blade attack, though.
Yeah, I'll take that now. My free Khan's bladed blade.
At the first penalty.
First penalty, yeah.
That's a hit!
Let's go!
Go, yammers.
Alright, it resists
3, somehow.
Yeah. Well, the blade's bladed blade does, like, different types of damage.
Oh, that's right. So. It does different types of damage. You're correct.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's the end of your turn.
Yeah.
Brings to Tal'Darris. Oh no! New friend Khan! Everyone, we must help her! And he runs in 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. But then, because he is a lawful creature, not understanding what is happening, he has to make a will save because by entering this room. 46. Okay, he's okay. He's in the zone, focused on helping Khan. He's not in think mode, thankfully. And he's going to take a second action. 1, 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30 to make that one off guard as well. Off guard for you. And then his last action will be to cast Fist once again, because his weapon has been taken from him. Oh, natural one! But he has such a high bonus that a nat one isn't even a critical miss. It's just a regular miss for Tal'Darris. So, into his turn, that brings it to Alzem, your, come on, go to Alzem, your new Grave Knight friend who is formerly a tiefling. Oh, this should be good. So Alzem's going to run in 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 35, she's got fast movement speed, and going to use, where is it? Devastating Blast. It is a 30-foot cone of electricity on all four of these.
Nice.
Well, one success, two success, three success, one failure, so that's something. So 8d12, that's a whole lot of damage. Whole lot of damage as a bunch of electricity is blasted out. That was way too... I think that might have been... No, that's right. Oh, no. Half... Three of those should have taken half of that. So that is way too much to fix. Oh, here we go. There we go. Oh, no, I guess that was right. Okay, great. All right, so that's the end of Alzheim's turn. This amalgamite number 4 didn't like that it got startled like this. First thing, which begins its turn. Shit. Oh, okay. So the first thing it's going to use is reposition. The amalgamite can transport and can teleport into an unoccupied space it could see within 50 feet. So firstly, it's going to teleport itself to here. And then use a warping ray on Khan. Ooh, natural 19, that's gonna probably crit. Oh, it didn't crit, wow. Low enough bonus that it does not crit on a natural 19.
Oh, yeah.
So you are blasted with 24 force damage, Khan. And you need to roll me a DC 33 fortitude save or become destabilized as it tries to hit you with a ray of teleport.
All right.
It tries to forcibly teleport you, essentially. 36, that is a success, so you are not displaced. Mm-hmm. That's the end of the Amalgamite's turn. Zavid, you're up.
I'm standing my ground.
All right. Zavid. It's going to take a little walk in. See this guy. It's Amalgamite.
Share this art. They're scary. Or they're freaky looking.
Yeah.
But I'm sorry, I'm really close to the screen. The resolution on this laptop is like 4K, but the screen isn't big. So it's like everything's very tiny. And I
saw it earlier,
like,
it's funny.
I have to like get really close to see my character sheet.
Oh my god, I forgot that you guys aren't in the right places because I think one of your screens did something. So everyone's in their normal spot now.
Sweet, thank you.
I forgot what... I think I have... Shit, I don't remember what my spell slots were. I know I got some big ones.
You have no ninths, no sixths. You've used at least 1/7, and I'm not sure about eighths.
I think I have my eighths. So I'm going
I'm
to
sure
do...
I'm sure you have at least 1/8.
Yeah, let me read this spell, because I have this on my sheet, so maybe this might work. 100 feet. Channel the forces of undeath to briefly call forth an amalgam of vengeful dead slain by your enemies and allies alike. This amalgam manifests as a large tornado of insubstantial howling faces that occupies the space of a huge creature and has a speed of 60 feet. Yeah, I'm gonna create a vortex of death right basically here if I could. If I would be allowed to like to do that. And
where? Right over there?
Yeah, it would basically be centered on this amalgamate, and then it would hit
oh,
these
shit.
Two guys around them. if that makes sense.
How big is it?
It's huge. So it would kind of fill,
but it's 3x3?
Yeah, I just
maybe. How about that?
There you go. Yeah, except can you push it back towards the wall so it's up against the wall a little bit and not hitting my friend? Thank you.
Yeah.
Alright, so this is Tempest of Shades. When it arrives, it does Vortex of Death. Each enemy creature within a 60-foot emanation. Uh-huh. Oh, within a 60-foot emanation. Jesus. Wow. Must attempt a fortitude save. So I guess all enemies in the room when this thing shows up.
How about that?
Sure. I summon all the fucking souls that got killed near this area. Summon them up and attack. So they need to make fortitude saves. My DC, I think, is 30.
All right. So I've made them all your target. Is that spell on your character sheet?
It might be. Yeah, I'm reading it on, so it must be.
Oh, yeah, then you should be able to make them take that save by clicking the gear and then doing whatever the save is.
So if I just do the save now, it'll work? All right.
There are your targets. It should just automatically. There they go. Oh, I see a nat 1 and a nat 2 and a 5.
Yo, all right.
Holy shit. All four critical failed. Holy shit.
They are drained 3.
Wow.
So these faces show up of people that were killed by these cultists. It's sort of like when Hades is going across the River Styx and those souls are climbing in the boat and he's like, get off of me. It's like that, except they don't get off. They grab onto these amalgams and they like suck the vitality out of them. No amount of chaos can save you from the wails of the damned.
But they're all drained?
Drained 3. Yeah, that's big. Drained
3. Holy crap.
That's big. Yeah.
That's very, very big. Oh my god.
So that's the first effect. And
yeah,
then,
it goes away after a round, right?
Yeah, at the end of my next turn, there's a depart effect. So we'll get to that later. But for now, that's what happens. That's my whole turn. That's all my actions is to do.
Good god. Okay. Oh, they're drained 3 as well. Shit. I need to fix that on all of them. Because it just defaulted to 1. So that's 3. And then 3. Drained 3. I think it lowers your maximum hit points by your level for every point of drained. So I think that was going to reduce their maximum hit points by like 39 each. That's crazy good. And then one of them is stunned 1, off guard, and drained 3. Good god. That's the end of your turn then, Zavid. Next. Okay, it's one of these amalgamites. Holy crap, he didn't enjoy that very much. So, spells. Ooh, yeah. He's going to attempt to hit you with that ray as warping ray from across the room, Zavid, as he raises a finger above its head, behind its back, and a strange ray of force shoots out at you and does hit. Not a crit, though, even though it was a nat 17. 29 force damage as you're blasted with this, and you can tell it's trying. Oh, no, you need to make me a DC 33 fortitude save.
Okay. Hold on. DC 33
fort save. Oh, you're good. That's a critical success. So that's the end of its turn. Reese, you are up. Oh, he's just now getting back, putting his headphones on. Good timing, Reese. You're up.
Oh, excellent. Planned that, you know.
Yeah, that was literally perfect timing.
Chat doesn't know, but I definitely stepped away to get some pizza. All right, so Reese,
you can walk into that vortex, so you know.
I can't?
You can, yes.
Oh, I can?
It will not hurt you.
Reese just kind of walks forward into the room. It's like, ooh, that's fun. But he kind of looks around and is like, you know what? No, I'm gonna still, like, move him over here. And he's going to... Actually, no, I'm not gonna have that because I forgot that I still have the decent-ish weapon.
You have a shitload of weapons.
Yeah, I have a pretty cool weapon. So, Gilhook has been doing him pretty good.
If you go southeast of that guy, you can make him off guard and get sneak attack.
Yeah, that's this way.
It's that way. There.
There we go. I am not good with cardinal directions.
Draw a straight line between you and Zavid, and if it goes through the guy, he's off guard.
Flat-footed. Perfect.
Flat-footed, off guard, same thing.
Okay, cool. If you said flat-footed, I would have got it.
Paizo had to change it because flat-footed is apparently like D&D trademark or something. Yeah, so it's off guard. But it's the same thing.
Oh, well, I'm gonna go and poke him, and...
Yeah. Oh, wow, a nat 2 was still a hit.
Still a hit, and that's before I even wogged up. Shit.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, either way, I'm gonna just poke him. Wait, is that with the ghost touch? Did I do ghost touch? I did ghost touch arrows, not...
Oh, that's okay. Yes, you did. So that's number 4? Okay, hold on. I can fix that. So 32, so that's... Okay, you're good.
Okay, there we go. Let's try that again.
Yeah, roll the gill hook damage. 43, pretty good. Yeah. Even better than the other. Or 33. Yeah, 43, good.
Yep. So
it is weak to piercing damage, as you see.
Yep. And that is good to know, because most of my stuff is piercing damage. And I think he's just gonna go for another hit.
Okay, this will be at your lowest. Oh wait, no, you only hit once, right?
Yeah, I only hit once.
That's right.
If I wog now, is that
okay? You max. Yeah.
Okay.
It's just a focus point.
Okay, yeah, I'm gonna do that.
Yes.
And then he'll hook you.
That sounded so mean. That 3, still a hit.
That was a good one.
51 damage, because again, they are weak to piercing. So you do an extra 10, even if you do any amount of piercing, they take 10.
Nice.
If you do 1 piercing damage, they take 11.
Okay, so that was 2 at max, and then now I do the...
1 at lowest.
1 at lowest? Okay.
Yep. Nat 17. That is hilarious.
That never happens.
That never happens. That's great. So yeah, all 3 attacks hit.
For damn. An additional
48 damage. You fucked that guy up real quick. He's looking pretty bad. Step. So Amalgamite 1 is going to... No, just from here, going to attempt a warping ray first at con, because you seem to be the immediate...
Oh no.
Immediate.
Immediate.
Going to Zavid, because you're another clear threat here. Gonna miss. And being very concerned with this, is going to just try and send a third one to Reese. Probably gonna miss. Natural 19! Ah!
Good luck.
Oh. But I had a miss chance. Fuck. So it should have crit, but because you're invisible... it missed.
Good.
So, with Zilka, the Ghast-tastic, is going to first use Quick Leap to make her way to here, because that was a straight line through the door, and then is going to begin juggling with her, in her right hand. She has an invisible juggling pin, an invisible health potion, and an invisible alchemist's fire, and in her left hand is a long spear. So she's going to flurry of blows at first this dude who's on the ground with her spear. Should have had her character sheet up, I apologize. Spear attack on this amalgamite number 4. 8 should hit, yep. Dealing 35 damage because it's piercing. And then with her, her flurry, she's going to hurl the bowling pin over to amalgamite 3, which is a hit. That's the one in front of Khan, so she threw it, an invisible bowling pin across the room, smacking it, and it comes flying back to her, and she catches it, or at least appears to catch the invisible bowling pin in the air. So that's jump, flurry of blows, and then she's going to just try to claw at this thing with her ghast claws with her last action. Probably miss, yeah. Charlie doesn't get an action. Amalgamite number 3. These guys don't have a lot... that they can do in this situation, which is bad for them. Here we go. This one is going to cast... Yeah. Going to cast Warp Mind on you, Zavid. So...
What?
I'm going to force you to make a will save. Oh, you critical succeed. Great. Basically, it tried to scramble your mental faculties and make you confused permanently. If you'd critically failed, you would have been confused permanently.
Tried to make your brain pudding.
Yeah, it tried to make your brain pudding, and it did not work. You critically succeeded.
If anyone out there watches One Piece, it's like the Usopp moment in Thriller Bark, where they try to depress, make him depressed, but he's like, I'm already depressed, so it like doesn't work
on him. Oh my god, it was so
I'm always confused! So it doesn't affect Zavid the same way.
It does not affect him at all.
Except
but
that it was a little bit more sad in One Piece.
Yeah, it was a little bit.
And so it is going to finish up with trying to shoot Zavid with its warping ray, hoping to hit. Nope, miss. These are not super high level. Danny, you're up. Yeah. You're also muted, just so you know.
Yeah, that's what I was trying to fix.
Gotcha, gotcha.
Okay, so I have a couple of questions.
Mm-hmm.
I am outside of this currently, correct? So I can't
That's
see
right.
anything?
Yeah, you're a little out of the room. You can kind of see there's a bunch of shit going on, but yeah, you'd have to run in to see what's going on.
Okay, so she's gonna run in. She'll be able to get right there. And... she's gonna first look to her allies and see how are they looking.
Khan took a little... Oh, Khan has been hurt. She took a big brain blast when she walked into this room. Khan is definitely hurt.
Yeah. Okay. And I assume that traveling with them enough, being as close as they everyone is, she would recognize Khan being, like, damaged.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Khan does not look great.
Okay. So... let's go with a... fifth level suit. For Khan.
Awesome.
Nice.
And then I just dropped the healing on her, correct?
That's right.
Okay. So.
There it goes. Maybe. I saw it roll.
I saw it roll too.
Oh, there it is, 45. Yep. Sweet. So 45 healing, Khan, as this soothing magic, this soothing song comes from your friend Danny, and that's all you can do, because it was one action to move, two action to cast Soothe, but Ares and Arwen can each have one action.
I feel like getting him in this room would probably be more problems than it would be, actually. So, I'm just gonna let them just sit out this one.
Sounds good. So that's the end of Danny's turn. I believe that's the end of the round. Yep, top of the round is Hamilkai. Hamilkai is going to, just punch this amalgamite that's in front of her with a flurry of blows. That's a critical hit. Great. Sixty-nine damage. Nice. That thing. Amalgamite 3 needs to roll a save. Where is it? There it is. A will save. Because Hamilkai used Scatterbrain Palm. And it fails, actually. So it is stunned 1. So on its next turn, it can only take 2 actions. But that is not the end of Hamilkai's turn. That was just half of its flurry of blows. So here's the second half. That's a hit. Good job, Hamilkai. A little bit of damage. Oh, and that kills it. Okay, so Hamilkai punches this thing to death.
I'd be shocked if it was still standing.
Yeah, and then last action takes a step forward to try and help with flanking. That's the end of Hamilkai's turn. Khan, you're up.
All right. Khan is going to expertly maneuver. Oh, wait. Yeah, that guy's dead. Expertly maneuver over here to flank.
Mm-hmm. Oh, let me give it that. There you go.
Yeah, and is going to make a series of attacks.
Series of regular hits. Critical attack. Not nice. With a 45. Yeah, you crit on a 15. That's pretty good.
Ooh.
So many D6s. 89 damage as you stab into this thing, discovering, as Reese did, that they are weak to piercing damage.
That's good to know. Yeah. Alright, I'm gonna do it again.
I'll do it again! That'll do. Yeah, that's another crit right there for 42. I love the Fantasy Grounds freezes when you crit, because it has so many dice. That kills it, 87 damage. So you kill it in two hits, and then you still have your free punch that you could throw to the one to your right, or to your left.
Yeah. Lowest penalty free punch.
They are resistant to bludgeoning damage, so this one is not going to do near as much damage. But you do hit with 38. 24 damage still, though. That's pretty good. Pretty good. Oh, yeah, that's right. It does do some piercing. That's right. So, with Khan's bladed blade, you do a pretty decent amount of damage to it. That's the end of your turn.
Yeah, making up for a little lackluster first turn for Khan, but it's fine.
Yeah, a little bit. But Tal'Darris is going to see his opening, run over here to fill in the gap and make this little dude off guard. Ah, we've nearly got this. Victory is at hand. Punch it in the face. Oh, that was almost a nat 20. But it's still a crit.
Dude's off guard.
It's still a crit with a natural 8. So 54 damage. And he's going to do it one more time. Oh, natural 1. Awesome. Ha-ha! Oh, he got too confident. And his turn, Alzim. Come on, Alzim. Can you finish this off? Come on.
Do it. Do it,
Alzim. Go up there. So, attack. Ooh, nat 1. Hell yeah. Alzim can't do it. Let's see. Last action. Hey, that one hit. So, stab with a sword. There's 25 damage. It's looking pretty bad, but it's not dead yet. That means it's... there's this one over here. I forgot about that. So this one is going to attempt to... Yes, limb attack at Yuzavid because you're right there. Just hit you with this arm that's up behind its head. That's a miss. Damn. Okay. These guys were not quite as nasty as I was expecting them to be. He's going to try to attack with Silka. Nat 20! There we go! But its bonus is so low, it's not even a crit. It's just a regular hit. So, Wasilka takes a little damage, and she has to make a save. Where is she? There she is. Oh, more than enough. The monk saves, obviously. End of the amalgamation's turn. Zavid, you're up. There are two of these left, and they both look pretty bad.
Oh, yeah. The rare actual attack roll from Zavid.
Oh, and you crit! With the Scorponok blade. That was made for you by your good friend Gunnar Sunson.
Does he die? He died!
He did! you straight up kill him with your blade.
I kill this guy, and then I like look around like, I did it! and then I will... Do the two action, do a telekinetic projectile on this guy.
Okay. Hold on. And then once that's done, your spell goes away, right?
Yeah, and then if he's still up, if he's still around, if he wants to show his sorry mug.
And remember, they are weak to piercing and resistant to bludgeoning, so since you're doing telekinetic projectile. Should be a hit. Yep, it's still a hit.
All right.
35.
You said weak to piercing? Sweet.
Whew. High level cantrips are still pretty gnarly. There it is. 41 damage. 51 damage. Yep,
he
still
needs
alive.
To make a will save at the end of my turn.
Yep, that is the end of your turn. It's still up, so will save. What's your DC?
38, I think.
40, it saves. So it should take half damage still.
Well, no, all it does is it's frightened one.
Oh, okay.
So it is still drained as it was before, drained two, I think, but it is frightened one, and that is the end of Tempest three. Of Shades. Cool. Well, I don't know how long drained lasts, if it like goes down by each round.
It goes down one every hour. And Reese, you're up.
Oh my god.
This thing is alive and next, but you could probably kill it.
Oh, I absolutely want to. Mm-hmm. So I think he doesn't want to get any closer to these things. They're kind of freaky. So he's going to take out, just for fun, because he's like, you know what? Might as well see how this goes. Gerald's Pride.
Hey, your first time using Gerald.
Yeah. And he's just like, I think my dad'd be proud of me for this one. Oh god, I have more than one dad. Who knew? So he goes...
But not in a gay way, oddly.
Not in a gay way, which is just even more bizarre.
There's anything wrong with that, I'm just saying. It's literally is.
Gay way? So suddenly you see this flowery bow. It is absolutely gorgeous. It looks like you could just pick it up from the earth, and you would think it was made of just a bunch of vines and stuff. So it looks kind of deceivingly wimpy. But he pulls back and goes and looks at the Amalgamite and tries to get him dead in the eye. And then, so he hits.
That's a crit. That's crit. Yeah, I was muted. Sorry, I was celebrating. And you kill it with one shot. One arrow.
And one shot goes into his eye and just goes back.
You get this thing right in the eye, which is in the center of its torso. And it falls over, twitching on the ground. We are out of initiative. Well done. You've killed the four Amalgamites. Now I need to turn off this music, because holy crap.
Yeah. This is a little intense.
Dungeon music. Something like that. Yeah, creepy dungeon. Okay, but we are out of combat. You see... Let me share this picture with you. Because now that those are dead, you can see that strapped to this table is a very large, what appears to be like a stone centaur with wings of that are connected to a backpack type machine. But it appears that this backpack is part of the creature. Like this almost looks like a construct of some kind. You'd need to make some kind of rolls to know more about
it. I want to do a crafting.
Crafting's fine. Throw that in the tower.
I do a society roll or something where she would have been read about.
Society would be fine, or any of the magic ones.
Actually, I'm going to do society. That's really smart.
Mm.
This is why I'm a PNG today, because I don't have a brain.
I'll go with Arcana or society. Which one?
Either one. Maybe Arcana, since Reese just did society.
Yeah.
Religion would also work. Okay, neither of you. Let me double check. You're level 17. Yeah, neither of you are sure what this is. It looks like a centaur made of stone. You know what centaurs are. Hmm?
Did you fix Reese, by the way?
What about him?
Did you fix his
AC?
Yeah.
No.
Okay.
But I don't think I attacked you in that combat.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, but do that now.
Yeah, that just reminds me.
Yeah, I didn't attack you during that, apparently. Because I would have critted every time on a 19, because that stupid glitch. Anyway, Danny and Reese, not enough to know. This thing looks like a carved stone centaur, but it is strapped down to this gurney and kind of moving around a little bit against its chains.
What was the skill check for that?
Arcana or religion?
You know me.
I do know you.
I put out my Bible. I say, what does the Bible say about this creature?
Well, actually.
Whoa, that was that's performance.
I was going to say that was not the right thing.
My religion bonus is 30, so 39 is what that should have been.
39, there, finally, someone. Danny, you're too struck by how hot this creature is. You rolled a nat 1. So I'm interpreting that as your monster fucker is coming out a little bit, and you just. I don't know that's what fair. That is, but I want it. I want one. But Zavid,
I wonder how Bruce would feel about it.
Zavid, with a, you said a 39?
Yes.
Yeah, you recognize that this is an inevitable. They come in different types and shapes and sizes. Basically, they kind of construct themselves when they come to Axis, is what you've heard. But you're not sure of how the process works. But you're fairly confident that this is probably an inevitable, because in much the same way that Tal'Darris looks like he is made out of armor, this thing looks like it's made out of stone. And I'll reshare a picture of Tal'Darris to show that as well. There he is.
Cool.
Because Tal'Darris is not a person inside of the armor. Like, look at his knees. You see how they're big ball joints? Yeah, he is like a big construct. All inevitables are.
I'll go to this guy and say, Tal'Darris, I believe this is another one of your kind, is he not?
Yes, it would appear it is an inevitable. What were they doing to him?
And he...
Is he dead?
No, he's just kind of, unconscious.
Okay.
Injured.
He's missing, like, a leg or something?
No, he's kind of has his hands are missing, and they were replaced with those chains, which are attached to knives.
Can, I go to Khan and be like, Khan, do you think we could rebuild him better, faster, stronger than before?
Make it better. Do it faster.
Makes we it have stronger. The technology.
But do you have $6 million?
I mean,
we have a legendary in crafting skill over here. I'm just saying, this guy's like out of stone. Maybe we can like repair him. You know?
Yeah. Ooh. We'll try. Let's try to fix up this rock centaur man.
If you take the lead, I'll aid you.
All right.
Okay.
Do you need any other additional help?
Is it difficult? Just them will be fine, Danny. Okay. You can give guidance to them both. So, yeah. Khan, do a plus one. All right, Zavid, give yourself a plus one and do whatever check you're doing to aid and do that publicly.
If I want to, like, meditate and channel it to be super hot, can I do, like, a society roll?
Sure. Throw that publicly.
Oh, publicly? Oops.
All right, it's whatever.
Can you make it public?
Yeah. You got a 35, which is a critical at this level.
Cool.
And you're a legendary in society, so that's 4.
Cool. So
I recently looked up how aid works, and it's different than I used to think.
Yeah.
Good God. Yo.
44, let's do this.
So, Khan, you get to add 6 to a crafting check and make it public. Yeah, aid is better than I thought it was.
We've been nerfing it this whole time.
Yeah, I've been nerfing it for almost four.
Oh.
Jesus Go ahead, Christ.
You tell me what happens, Khan. Nat 20 for anyone listening.
Nat 20 plus all the aid you just
plus
got.
Plus all the aid, so it was a 58.
58?
Nat 20.
It is impeccably hot, isn't it?
That was incredible. So, yeah. Khan, I'm just going to sit back. You tell us what happens.
Oh, and guidance for 59.
Yeah.
No, guidance was part of the 6.
Oh, okay, got it.
okay, so... Oh my God, where do I even start?
That's the question, isn't it?
Yeah. I think the way that Khan is going to fix up this guy, are parts of him broken off? I see that there's like big cracks in the body. Is that where most of the hurt is?
Yes, that and there's a lot of cracks and the hands are missing.
All right.
Those chains are very much like Kratos. You know how he has the chains permanently attached to his forearms?
Yeah.
But imagine Kratos with his hands lopped off.
Okay. Ooh. So, first of all, Khan is going to use her alchemical know-how to create some sort of super-powered glue that can repair the cracks in the rock, so that, you know, his handsome horse body is as strong as it possibly can be. And then she's going to use her mechanical know-how to make prosthetic arms for him.
Wonderful. And there's more than enough material within this lab to be able to do that. And eventually you are able to fix enough damage that he begins to come to regain consciousness a little bit, because healing magic won't help as a construct. But it eventually does begin to come to and says to you, "Where am I? Am I dead?"
No, not by a long shot.
You are maybe the luckiest inevitable that has ever come into existence. You ran afoul of some usurpers of Norgorber. These were agents of power most foul. You ran afoul, foul. Anyway, I would like to introduce you to your savior, and I point to Khan, and I give you a big introduction. Khan de Bloody Rizzolo, master crafter, and the one that has returned your arms to you.
And they look down, and they see hands, mechanical hands that you built from scrap in a cave with a box of scrap.
Box of scraps!
Yeah. Box of scraps! And it clenches its fists and says, "Thank you. I remember. Yes. They've been keeping us in here. They've been trying to take our calculations. That's right. Oh, I'm sorry. You are not inevitable, are you?" And it looks to Tal'Darris and says, "I'm sorry, I'm still confused and weak. Can you please explain to them how we become this way?" Tal'Darris says, "Oh, yes, of course. Well, we inevitable. We begin as mortals, you see. And upon the plane of Axis, we absorb the law, the very elemental nature of the law that comes from the plane. And in order to raise yourself up, you must solve a mystery of the universe. It is how each of us becomes inevitable. I myself found quite a bit of information about rays that come from very distant stars, but that is for discussion for another time. It would appear..." And he's looking really close at Pavarish, at this... Yeah, I already said the name, whatever. They introduced themselves as Pavarish 19. I didn't do that in character, but that is their name, Pavarish 19. But Tal'Darris is looking over Pavarish, and eventually he looks around at the walls, and he suddenly realizes why Khan had to take a brain blast, because he himself has to take 10d10 damage.
Oof.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And I get to re-roll 1, 2, 3 of those because they were 1s. Because he's lawful. Oh, and two more of them were 1s again. That's better. Okay, so that's 60 mental damage as the awful Tal'Darris starts looking around and sees all this math on the wall, and he goes,
KO mathematics!
Can I do a society roll?
Absolutely. And Khan, you could do crafting if you want.
Power
make them publicly. Make them
to put some more super glue in the crack that just formed in his head.
Yeah.
The way he reacted to the mathematics is the way that I imagine people who are part of a fandom, when they come across the other end of that same fandom that they disagree with, they're like, ugh! You know what I mean? Everyone can relate to something like that. Like exactly. Shippers of characters that you don't think should be shipped or something like that. Like, ugh!
Mm-hmm.
The ones who were rooting for Reese and Danny all along.
Okay, so Reese, you get you've heard of that there are other realms outside of ours. There are different universes, different realities, and you realize this might be physics from a different reality, some kind of a chaotic abyssal type physics that lawful creatures are like. The more you understand about how the material realm works, the more it fucks with your brain. Which is why, again, Reese didn't take any damage at all when he walked into the room.
Well, and also it explains why, for Khan, why... I think it starts clicking in place why Khan wouldn't understand it and why she took damage.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I think both are true. All of the above.
Yes. But then, after he regains his senses again, Tal'Darris says... Pavarish speaks up and says... They were trying to take my calculations off of my body, look, and if you look closer, which I'm sure most of you don't mind too bad, looking closer at this guy, you can see that there's math carved in tiny writing all over him. You know how, like, when people do writing on a grain of rice? It's like that. Just tiny, tiny math all over this body. And you can see that there's been a lot of changes made. There's different handwritings on different parts of these equations, and you can see that they're all kind of squiggly and weird and disproportionate. They kind of even remind you of those amalgamites you just fought. And Khan, I won't make you take damage for it, but they kind of hurts your eyes to look at them.
Yeah.
And you can tell it's the same shit. They're putting this chaotic math they're basically tattooing this chaos math onto this lawful creature. Essentially, even though he's made of stone, but it's basically a tattoo.
Yeah.
So you realize that.
What does this math even do? Why do they need to? Why are they doing it?
Are they trying to fundamentally change you?
I mean, I do feel quite strange. It is a different feeling having all these.
The more he's looking at the sigils, and they start to kind of glow, and he begins to kind of buckle at the spine, and he says,
I can feel the chaos in me. The numbers form who we are. This chaos feels like a virus.
Well, you know, really, theoretically speaking, if you take chaos and law you put together, it would just change your form into some sort of neutral outsider. It shouldn't, like, kill you, right? Right?
Perhaps, but it is against what we are fundamentally.
Well, can't you remake yourself? I mean, we've repaired your outer form. Clearly, there's something going on inside. How do you purge these mathematics from your being?
I must stay away from other inevitables. This will spread to them if I cannot remove it from myself and reclaim the correct math.
So this is how you get the hot centaur away from me and me and Ash. This is how you do it.
What I do it with math. I do it with math.
Oh, the math. It's so math.
I fucking hate math even anymore.
Math
is sex killer.
I'd like to look at that book that's sitting there and give it a good once over. I want to see if there's any clues here.
Sure. Give me an occultism check immediately.
Immediately, right now. yeah. Hold on a sec. Let me just. Please be occultism. The cursor is so big.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is definitely a magic book of some kind. The title says Inversions of Pentanometry.
I nod and I say it's written in words.
That's how most books are written, Zavid.
Let me look at this. Let me decipher it. What is it written in?
When you open it. When you open it, it's in a very strange script I don't think you recognize. At least let me double check. What do you speak, Zavid?
A lot of not.
Oh, it's an abyssal. You have it.
Oh, it's an abyssal.
But geez, Reese, with your 50 society, you can also kind of read it behind. Yeah, over his shoulder.
So I'll read it
like the peer over.
Like, so, like, Reese and I, like, I know the language, so I read the language, and then with your society, you figure out what it means.
Yeah.
It's almost like reading a poem, and then you understand the meaning of the poem kind of situation.
Yeah, I agree.
So what does this verse mean? Like, what are they talking about here?
And then that's simple. That means they're talking about this and this. Like, it's not on our plane, but it's pretty obvious, even though we don't understand what the fuck they're saying. That clearly,
what it's they rhyme time with time. Why did they do that?
It's the spice time.
Yeah, it's spelled two different ways. Time is spelled differently.
But then why did he say he was out of time? He's not cooking anything here. Oh, I hate this.
Time is so good.
I love that.
So you're reading through this book, and it seems like a textbook. It's very back and forth train of rambling train of thought. Stream of consciousness. That's the term I'm looking for. Very stream of consciousness type textbook on physics and cosmology and the universe. And you're starting to understand that if this stuff makes these inevitables kind of sick, that, and the cabal does not want anyone in Axis to help out when they attempt to release Rovagug at the conjunction. If they can make all of the inevitables of Axis sick with this chaotic mathematics, well, that would take out a large chunk of the forces now, wouldn't it?
Yeah. So when they say they're running out of time, they're just being cheeky right now. While the spelling makes no sense, it means that they literally are running out of time itself in order for the attack to happen. So they're trying to chain up these inevitable, I think, and try to make it harder for us to fight back and have more forces. Greece basically is like, duh, obviously.
A doy.
Nerd.
I guess I'm like looking at this like, all right, well, how did they put this sort of chaos math into you in the first place?
They took chisels and carved it onto me over my previous functions.
Oh, where are they, if you don't mind? I mean,
kind of all over.
But
like I said, it's sort of like when people write on a grain of rice, so you have to get really close to really see it.
Reese goes in his
I volunteer.
Reese and Danny, yes.
Perception checks publicly.
Let me just get Danny over
I mean,
there.
I'll make one, but I feel like I get pushed out of the way as I'm like
you
trying
do.
To look.
Oh, yeah.
Wow, that guy was really, really scooting.
Oh, that's occultism. Whoops.
I'm gonna use a hero point.
Okay. That was a low roll.
I really need to take a good hard look.
I think that I would works. Also like to use a hero point.
Okay. So what's at the highest yet so far? 38 for con?
37, 38, oh. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Great, Danny. Let's see.
Big money.
No whammies.
All the whammies.
No.
Big whammy, no money.
Oh, that's disgusting.
So
you guys are too busy grabbing onto his abs and shit. Like, you're supposed to be reading.
No, I'm only one under... I'm only one under con. Excuse you, that's yeah, Danny.
Reese and con succeed.
I get it, he has rock hard abs. He's made of rock.
That is definitely Danny.
Yeah, that's like, definitely Danny.
Yep, this is rock hard.
This is...
I'm stone.
This is hard.
Actually, stone. I'm but a stone
Con,
man thing.
Con, you can see that a lot of the equations have been defaced, for lack of a better term, with tiny little chisels and like files and just rock, you know, rock statue carving stuff.
Yeah.
Can we make like a little coding that this is above table because
Yeah.
Or we could just say Reese is something similar because this is too smart for Reese. Can we make a putty or something to put into the cracks and fix those?
That's what I was thinking.
Oh my god, okay, cool. Yeah, so then let's see. Reese just goes, can we just repair this? Like, is there something that can make him less crack?
What about a sander?
Would that hurt?
It would probably hurt him, but we...
Sounds like exfoliation.
Yeah. And he's just like, he needs to be exfoliated, I'll help.
At this point, Hamilkai will kind of come up behind you and, you know, very like one of this type deals, not really wanting to butt in on your conversation, but saying,
well, so you know, there are a lot of alchemy labs within the Lost Silhouette just to the south. Be careful of this double door here. There's actually a trap just behind it. Just like the blade trap in the break room. Be careful with those double doors there. But there are some alchemy labs. You might be able to find some salves or some type of putty in there.
That makes sense. That makes sense. Thank you.
Yes, of course.
How does she feel about the ripped centaur man?
I haven't been in this room, to be truth be told. The secret shade keeps our business very separated down here in the silhouette.
I want everyone to roll me an arcana check publicly on that book, The Inversions of Pantanometry.
Yeah.
Arcana, yeah, sure. Also, I want to summon Tal'Darris with me, like, hey, stay away from the other inevitable while they got that virus. I'm using a hero point.
Of course, yes, that is definitely a good idea. I should stay away from Pavarish.
And also, protect me from harm, thank you, in advance.
I can do that, yes, of course.
And he slaps you on the back, and his hand, he leaves a handprint.
I'm, like, part of me is sticking to his hand. I'm, like, dripped on it like I'm putty, and then I and okay, I have to, well, like, reform. Ugh.
Khan and Zavid, after a while of looking at the equations on Pavarish, the defacing, the book, the math on the wall, you finally figure out that this book, Inversions of Pantanometry, is slightly more than just a textbook. It's a magic item. It counts as a plus one intelligence, a tome of clear thought plus one, which will, if you read it for a week, 1 hour a day, it will increase your intelligence score permanently by one, as per the normal rules for skills above 18. But at the end of it, you have to roll a DC 40 will save, and if you fail, you gain a minus four penalty permanently against illusions and anything else that would confuse you.
Okay, what if Khan has her, like, mega ADHD brain that day? How quick does it take?
I mean, that's a risk she would have to take.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's right, you have to take that risk.
She doesn't have to read it. She doesn't have to read it. But, Khan, you go to your main tab and look at your skills. You see how there's that little button under to the right of dexterity under partial?
Yeah.
Once you get to 18, every five levels, it only goes up by one instead of two. So when you hit level 20, your dex will hit plus six. But even if you were to put a point into intelligence at level 20,
it would still only go halfway.
But if you were to read this book and then hit level 20, you could have a plus six intelligence. But again, you need to pass a DC 40 will save at the end, and there is always the chance. It's pretty high, but...
That is real. I would have to roll a 15 or higher. That's like a 25% chance.
Mm-hmm. With hero points and stuff.
With hero points.
I'm going to put it in your inventory. You don't have to start reading it now. It takes a week.
We're in the middle of a situation. Once we're in the middle of a situation.
Yeah, you can't even really start reading yet. But I've dropped that in your inventory. I think with this Pavarish, it's going to kind of pass back out of exhaustion.
Okay.
That's been kind of a lot for them.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So docile now. He looks over to Danny. Can we keep...
I mean... Zavid, can we keep him?
What do you mean? Like a pet?
I mean, he would be great in Druma. Like, after all of this, can you imagine? There's so much land, he would love it.
Sure, if he wants. He's a sapient creature. He can make his own decisions.
I know, but he's asleep right now. I just want to plan before he knows.
Tal'Darris is right here. He's also an inevitable.
I know that.
He has free will.
I'm just saying, he looks really cool, and I think
I helped Khan rebuild his, like, arms and stuff. He's cool as fuck, but, like, let's just be real here. Like, if he wants to stay in Axiom, that's his decision.
Okay,
if we can't fix him, he might come with us, but we should still try to fix him.
That's fair.
I want to open these double doors. Before they, like, get any ideas.
Okay. I want you to describe exactly how you're opening these doors. What are you doing?
Are they push?
They are pull.
Okay, I slowly pull. How heavy are they? Are they, like, really hard to pull?
They're pretty thick. I described at the very beginning of the dungeon a couple sessions ago that all the walls and all the doors are very, very thick and soundproof. So if you've ever been you've been in a recording studio, you know how the doors are, like, always this thick?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Very much like that.
I would like to then look out with my true sight and see if there's anything.
Oh, that's
weird.
Right. Yeah, you see, and also Hamilkai told you that there is a trap right there.
Oh. I see.
In fact, I can just go like that.
I say, this whole area is just a big trap.
Yes, we don't use that door when we come into this room. We always avoid it. That's for people who are, not supposed to be here. It's to trip them out.
I close that door. I'm like, alrighty. I open this door.
That door, huh? Okay, give me just a second. Come on. Oh, that's why. It's on the layer thing. Okay.
Only an idiot would use that door.
Only a moron uses the double doors.
What kind of idiot would try that door first? Why don't you help me out? Why don't you tell me which door to open?
Reese just goes, ooh, double doors. Just kidding.
Ooh, okay. I wouldn't open those doors.
There we go. Bam. All right. So you see a kind of a long hallway that goes down into another room that has a long table with several chairs. Oh, I have a description. A large table stands in the center of this room, surrounded by 8 medium chairs and 2 large seats. The entire room is supernaturally kept at a dim light. And I want you to roll a perception check in the tower before I say or reveal anything else.
Sure. And as I do that, I want like that guy to be like, or I want her to be like, no, not the hallway of death. And I'm like, what?
Oh no! Not any room but that.
The boardroom meeting table of doom. Stay out of there.
There are snacks that make you focus during the meeting.
What did you need me to roll? I'm sorry. Perception.
First, if you're going that far, stealth, but definitely perception, both in the tower.
Here's perception, and then also here's stealth to see if I could even get into this place.
Okay. Ooh, that was pretty high, actually. Okay, so you got a 43. I actually have to roll against that. Ah, failure! Good for you! So I'm going to back you up just a little.
Okay, yeah, yeah. Because I'll probably spot whatever
is in there. You'll spot it before you get that far, so I'll put you maybe there. So what you see is...
Oh, shit!
Yeah, there's several creatures standing in this room. The first one you see is a very strange black winged creature with horns that appears to be glowing from the inside. Give me a nature or occultism in the tower. That's the first thing you see.
I'm so glad Reese didn't stupid his way into this.
Yeah, it's a good thing that I'm doing. I'm stupiding my way into this.
Wow. Okay, so 40, you know that this is an Anko, which is a type of a fey. It's a very powerful fey. It's like a little 17 creature. You also see... I mean, well, maybe not from that angle, but there are also 2 more undead Axiomite Grave Knights in the corner.
I hear some talking, maybe.
You hear talking. But you can't see who they're talking to at this point.
Yeah,
you see that big creature for sure.
Can I hear the language they're speaking in?
Infernal.
I know that. What are they saying?
Let me double check.
And when, like, as you're doing all of that, would you think that it would make sense to have Hemelkai come over and make it look like he's just doing his rounds?
Sure. Hemelkai's not supposed to, like, leave their area.
Oh, shit, is that true? Okay, never mind.
So instead, I think I'm still not spotted. I'm silent.
He's not spotted.
I'm a shadow. But what are they talking about while I'm spying?
They are talking about how you have not fulfilled your end of the contract, devil. We will have what we desire, or you will have to speak to answer to Asmodeus and Norgorber. That's what the Fae is yelling.
Okay, I'd like to look back towards. I mean, I'm slowly like turning, and I want to. I do this to try to like coax one of you to cast message on me so I can talk to you.
I'll cast message.
Reese sees that and goes, Danny's like, do message.
I will relay to you. Yeah. I'll relay to you what I'm seeing and that I'm ready to fucking destroy this creature. I've got a spell ready. I need you guys to be ready to back me up to like rush into the.
He just goes, Do you have any idea what kind of magic works, or what kind of damage works best on it?
I will respond. I'm planning on destroying its soul.
Okay.
With that, though, Zavid, with your occultism role, you also know Cold Iron.
Oh, and Cold Iron's Fae.
Okay, perfect.
There's also, I hear, they're speaking Infernal. There might be a devil in there, but that might actually be a good thing. We could maybe, they seem to be pissed off at the devil, and we want to meet with Asmodeus at some point, so we could actually get an ally out of this.
Excellent.
I'm going to turn back around. I'm going to levy my hand at it. And I'm going to, at 8th level, cast Spirit Blast on the Anko.
Hell yeah.
So let's just review what that does. You concentrate ethereal energy and attack a creature's spirit, their very soul itself, dealing, I'm heightening this 2 levels. So this will be 20d6 force damage. I'm going to try to destroy its soul. If I can do that.
Well, make it take whatever save that is.
All right. Do whatever the fuck that
does. Whatever the fuck that does.
Here we go. Here's the save.
If you want, you could lucky get it and make it roll at disadvantage.
I want to lucky get it.
All right. Roll that again, though. Because that was a nat 17. That was high.
You lucky get.
Oh, shit. Well, we'll go with the half damage. So roll it in the chat, and I'll give it a half damage, because it rolled a nat 20 on the lucky get.
All right. But... So that's not all the dice. I upcast it.
Okay.
So here's a few more.
Okay.
So
70, so 35?
35 force damage as I try to rip apart its very essence. And that... We'll probably start a battle.
That does start a battle, so everyone please roll initiative.
What if he just, like, stands around like, what? Huh? What's going on? Why did that hurt all of a sudden? Huh?
They do stealth.
Absolutely.
Ooh, that one. Well, that's fine.
If you want to do stealth, you are welcome to do stealth.
I got an attack right at the top of the round, so I don't mind getting in that one.
Yeah, that's true, you did. Oh, wow, Con. Natural 20. And then Tal'Darris.
Oh, Reese.
Nat 4. Womp womp. And then with Silka. Good lord, there's a lot of y'all now. Is that everybody? Yes, that is. I think everyone.
By the way, I'm prone when I did that. I'm crawling, so people can jump right over me if they have to, like, just move over me.
Hell yeah.
Okay.
Con, you are up first. You got a nat 20, so anything is flat-footed to you.
All right, cool.
Why is...
Sick as hell.
Let's see. First things we gotta do is move. So, 1, 2, 3. Excuse me, Reese.
Oh, four, yeah, no problem.
5, 6. And then I don't want to get in the way of destroying souls, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Ah, I can't quite get in range to do a melee.
You could have thrown like a lightning or something.
Oh, that's true. Come on.
My spells. You have magic.
Oh yeah, you have magic.
Yeah.
It is very funny as a melee main in this game to be like, oh right, I have magic.
Yeah. I don't think I could, I don't know, I kind of want to save my chain lightning because I only get one of those.
You could finish up the movement and you take your free bladed blade attack.
Yeah.
All right, so you're going to there. So this one's automatically off guard to you because you went first, so go ahead.
Yeah.
Do the footage of the rat jumping at the camera.
Yeah.
rolled a hit. You rolled a damage first.
I'm getting ahead of myself.
You're probably going to hit. Oh, yeah. Oh, hey! So, hang on, let me heal it and then roll your... Just give it a... Give me a second. Okay, now roll on it.
Cool. Oh my god.
Incredible rat trick!
Whoa. Incredible rat trick. 72 damage with a single punch to the back of the noggin. Or how do you hit it? Where do you hit it?
Yeah, back of the noggin. Like, there's just, like, a hole in its head now. As Khan, like, leaps towards it, fist reeled back, and then... It goes, ow!
Oh, rats!
Oh, a rat!
Rats, rats!
That's the end of your turn. Reese, where the hell are you going?
Oh, wait, that's, okay, that, see, I was thinking that was the camera view. You can move me back. I'm sorry.
Okay. Where are you sneaking off to?
Where are you sneaking off to? Oh, God.
There we go. This Anko, seeing it's under attack, is going to say, oh, this blasted devil! This blasted devil has sounded the alarm! Attack! Kill her! And it's going to cast Darkness. And make it difficult to see. I can make it just like a circle. Pointers, circle. You now need dark vision here. Or I guess that would be... Yeah, it can be placed wherever. So you need dark vision inside the circle to see anything. Otherwise, everything is essentially concealed to you. So I'm going to give concealed to everybody. So that's the end of Fricka's turn. It is up to Phlegomi. Phlegomi, you hear a voice from inside this darkness. That's let me see. Do I have... Oh, perfect. Zavid, next to you, you just hear some magic and some flames as she casts Dimension Door and appears behind you and says,
I do not know who you are, but I definitely thank you for saving me.
And she will give you the aid action, Zavid. So let me see here. She's going to do an Arcana for an aid. So you're going to get a 3 on the next whatever you do, whatever you roll.
Okay.
This brings it to Tal'Darris. He says, darkness or no, we need to help out. And he casts the jump spell to leap above that, get to here, and is going to simply punch because that's all he can really do at the moment. But he has true seeing at will, so he can see in the darkness. That's a hit for his punch.
Not to mention I'm really good at punching things.
He does a little bit of lawful damage. That's the end of his turn because he had to jump. With Silka is going to quick leap over Zavid. She also has dark vision, so she's going to quick leap again to the other side of the Anko and then use Flurry of Blows with the spear. Is that a hit? No. Second attack. That might. Yes. A little bit of damage from Wasilka, 21, and her turn. Grave Knight. Ooh, I can't see anything. He's going to move to here. I'm going to see if he will trip all over this chair.
Goobly goo, where are you?
He knew where the chair is. He rolled quite high in his perception. So he remembers approximately where you're at, Khan. But I'm going to give you the concealed condition because he's dark in here. So he will have, even if he hits, he will have a chance to still miss. So he's going to swing at you. Nat 20, but natural 19. So it was a crit. So
right,
that I rolled a nat 20 followed by a nat 19. So
fucking rats.
That's fucking rats.
Oh, you're quiet, Lobby.
Something happened to your audio, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Nope.
No.
Still nothing.
No.
Shane takes over.
No.
Oh, wait, yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, a little bit.
Unmute yourself on Zoom. And say words.
You're muted.
You're muted. You're muted now.
How about now?
Yes. There we go.
He's back. He's back.
Hooray. Great. Sorry about that. I accidentally unplugged my mic with my... I got excited and flailed with my mic.
Ladies and gentlemen, we got him.
So, I don't even remember what I was doing. Second attack. Ah, there we go. So, it would have been a hit, but because of the darkness, it missed you, Khan. So, that's the end of its turn. Reese, you're up.
Okay. So, Reese, honestly, can... He doesn't have dark vision or anything, right? He's just a regular elf. He is an elf. But these other things are elves, or are they half elves, so is that why they can't see?
They are half, yeah.
Okay, so that's why they can't fully see. Reese would have no problem.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, cool. Reese is just gonna be like, oh, excuse me, pardon me. It's fine. Sorry, I'm gonna squeeze through. And he's just gonna like use this little alcove as like a nice little like place to kind of like hide, even if like he can't be. Oh, Jesus Christ. Okay, hold on. There we go. Moving the camera with the other direction. And he's gonna take a look at the Anko and just go, ew. And I think what he's going to do, since he did say, what is not good with it? It's iron, he said.
Cold iron. Cold iron is weak. It's weak to cold iron. Yeah.
I don't have anything with cold iron, do I? It's all steel. Shit.
I think you might have daggers.
I have silver daggers. Yeah.
Oh, silver daggers. Okay.
That's what I got. I got silver daggers, but everything else is that. Right. So, I think what hold on one sec. What does ghost touch affect?
Like ghosts and spirits.
Okay. All right. So I think what he might do, you know what? Obviously, he's going to do his wog. And then I think what he'll do then is I'll try like the cold damage.
Mm-hmm. Cold arrow. Cool, cool.
Yep.
Okay, so let's see that attack. Or attacks, two of them.
Yep.
Ooh, nat 18. That's pretty good. Definitely a hit.
Let's do the other one.
48. That one's probably gonna miss. Yeah. Okay. So just roll damage once. Sweet. And I think it was two actions to get there, right? Or was it just one?
It was just one.
Okay, then you have one left.
And then just that'd be at my lowest?
Mm-hmm.
Nope.
All right, yeah, that's gonna miss. So, this guy blindly swinging around him. Oh, don't like these rats! It's so dark in here! Hit butt. Ooh, nat 20 on his concealment. So I wasted a nat 20 on a concealment, at least.
Okay.
So he hits you, Khan, a little bit, for 31 damage.
Ah! Oh, pain!
keep swinging blindly. That was a regular-ass miss. And then last one. Come on. Short sword against Khan. Just a regular miss, even with a nat 17. Okay, and it hits her, and Hamilkai is up, and she says,
hopefully we can get that devil some help. Here, quickly, come this way.
And she's going to use her actions to give this devil a reaction to move into this room. Alzem will say,
I'll help you out.
5, 10, 15, 20... 25, 30, 35, just jumps right over Zavid. And then a second action to get there. And then one short sword attack against the Fae. Maybe? Nah, miss. Danny, you are now up finally. And then Zavid, you're on deck.
All right. Okay. So, I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
What are we fighting against?
It is a large Fae creature. It's called an Anko.
And we are in darkness, correct?
You would be if you go to the south, yeah.
And that's where all the fun stuff is happening?
Yes, right. Yeah, to the south.
Okay. I don't know. There's something that I find funny, like, Danny's been really good this whole time and, like, everything, but recently maybe she's been, like, playing with, like, darker magics and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, I have this, like, idea where she summons a devil or a demon, but she knows them really well, so it's like, hi, Dan! Can I need you to go take care of some stuff real quick?
That's hilarious. Do you have Summon Fiend?
Yes. So that was what I was talking to you about last week. So I wanted to get rid of Summon Fae for Summon Fiend.
Right, right. What level are you casting it at?
I'm going to cast it at... So it's a level 10 creature, so that means I'm going to be casting it at level 8.
Okay. Which one is the creature?
I think it's going to be... Let's see.
Oh wait, you said it was a level 8 creature? Is that what you said?
It's a level 11 creature.
11 creature. So yeah. I have Greater Nightmare, or well, let's see what I've got. So a level 11. Come on, 11. 11. I could do a Greater Nightmare. That's basically like a demon horse. Or unless there's a one you want. There's Moonagola, an executioner devil. I just know that I have the nightmare here in Fantasy Grounds.
Oh, executioner devil. That sounds badass.
Executioner. I don't have it. Devil. Oh, no. Barbed devil? Is that the same thing? Oh, I could do a barbed devil.
I'll take a barbed devil.
Barbed devil? You got it.
I'd like his name to be Dan, and we have, like, sometimes I summon him and we have long conversations.
Love that. So Dan appears in a square that you would like. So where would you like Dan to appear?
Right next to the bad creature.
Okay, you got it. So I believe it is blue barbed devil appears. What does this look like when you summon it? I have this picture of it right here. It is a spiky blue fiend with claws on all of its hands and large teeth. Aww. And very Vegeta-like hair.
Like, I imagine, like, Danny's been, like, because she hasn't taken Abyssal or Infernal on her sheet yet, but, like, I imagine she's been practicing a bit, and maybe preparation for, you know, going to hell, whatever.
Hey there, Queen. What can we do? What do you need today?
Hi, Dan. I need you see that I can't see it, but you can probably see it. There's some creatures in there that's causing some problems for my friends, and we need you to kill them. So the quicker that happens, the quicker we go to hell. So
got it.
Stay behind.
Return home.
Got it. He's gonna swipe out with his claws. And miss, unfortunately. But I think as a summon, that's all three of your actions.
Yep.
So that brings it to, I think, Zavid. Yes.
All right. The Anko. Can I get a vibe check to see whether or not they seem like they're going to try to flee or...
That's a great question. Let me check with the notes, because there is actually a thing for that. Yeah, it doesn't say, so it seems very angry that it is being attacked right now, but it doesn't seem like it's casting anything to escape. And let me see if it has any spells. I mean, maybe on its turn. You're not sure right this moment.
Okay.
It seems very mad, though.
Yeah. I don't want to chance it escaping. But I also am running out of spell slots. I don't remember. I'm trying to keep track, but it's hard. I'm going to do telekinetic projectile.
Mm-hmm.
And I get a +3 to this.
Okay.
Because I got the aid action.
That's right. You do. Yep. And so, it is off guard. So that's essentially mathematically a +5.
Okay. So +5 to this.
Oh, God. Roll.
Yep. Nah, you can go ahead and hero point that.
I think I want to reroll it again anyway.
All right.
Yeah, let's try that one more time. Also, I forgot to give my hero points at the start of the session. So I'm incrementally going up by 3, but it's still,
it's still not quite enough.
So I'm not wasting a turn. I will spend every hero point I have.
You need a 40. Oof.
Here, have mine.
Last one.
It's 40 is what you're needing. Ah.
Okay, use one of mine.
Ouch.
Well, that would, plus 5 is a 41. That would actually hit.
Oh, would that?
Oh, yes, that one does. So Reese, take yours back. Go ahead and roll damage then.
Okay, rolling the damage. Now, do I know whether or not any bludgeoning, slashing, piercing would be effective against this?
The only thing you know is that it would be weak to cold iron. The rest, there's no positive or negative.
All right, well, I'm going to slash the fuck out of it.
Ooh, that's a lot of D6s. Yeah, all of it goes through, all 65.
Chunking out projectiles, send blades flying towards it, cutting it up, and then with an action, I will... Can I give aid to somebody, or do I have to be next to them to do that?
I think you have to be next to them. Unless you can call something out like a weakness. Like, you can aid from a distance. Why not?
I'm going to aid Tel'Darris.
Cool.
Basically using that telekinetic strike to give him an opening. And that'll be my turn.
Great. So, end of your turn. Hop of the round. Khan, your turn.
All right. Khan's not looking so good. She's a little, hurt.
Yeah.
I don't see this, so I'm like, we're winning! We got this! Nothing could go wrong.
Ever.
At all, at any point.
Never, ever.
Oh. Let's see.
I think you have a spell that could get you out of dodge.
I do. And although Khan doesn't like running away, she might have to in this moment. I think she's going to use Blink Charge. Not to attack any of these bozos, but to attack the Anko?
I think? Anko? I'm not entirely sure.
Yeah, you gotta say it like a Jackie Chan calls his uncle in Jackie Chan Adventures. Anko!
Anko!
Anko! Like that, yeah.
Okay, so you can place yourself wherever you like and then attack it.
Yeah, I'm just pulling up what it says in the spell to remind myself how much extra damage it does.
Oh yeah, it does a 2d8 force if you hit.
Yeah. So yeah, she's teleporting over here. So is she instant transmissions?
Yeah.
And she's going to attack. Take this, fiend!
Take it! Take this, fiend! Oh, that should do hit. Yep. So roll your damage and then do... that's full damage. So it'll be 2d8 force. So yeah. That wasn't correct. Is it not flat-footed? Hang on. It's not. Let me give it back 20 and you can re-roll that damage. That isn't correct. Okay, go ahead. It's fixed.
That's
better. Okay, there you go. Now roll 2d8 in the chat and I'll add it to that. It's looking pretty bad. If you could hit it one more time, I think I could die.
I can.
Yeah.
Because it was two actions. Oops. To do the teleport plus the strike. So she still has two more actions.
Great. And it's at your max because that was a spell. That doesn't count against your... penalty, your attack bonus penalty.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, that's one of the nice things about being a Gish. Ooh, that'll do it. Yep, so you're not going to need it, but go ahead and roll the damage. Yeah, it had 5 hit points. So, what do you do, Khan?
So I feel like the Grave Knights were just like blindly trying to slash at this rat with their swords, but they like simultaneously raise their blades and then bounces off the ground because she's gone. And then right as this spooky fae is readying an attack from behind, it feels two very quick stabs right into its neck. It falls over. It keels over. Dead.
And it flops to the ground, completely inactive, bleeding out on the tile. I think yourself, well, it would be the free action, so you can't really take it unless you want to punch Basilka.
Yeah. Nah. I fist bump her.
Fist bump Basilka. There you go.
One action to fist bump.
Free action to fist bump. So let's see, that brings it to this devil. Does she have anything she wants to do?
Is the darkness gone, perchance?
Oh, it would be gone at this point. Oh, yes. Goodness. Good point. Good point. So
Reese just kind of like finally sees Dan is like, oh wow, you are way more here than I thought you were. Like he could see in the dark, but not that close.
Yeah, she's gonna run to here.
Dan won't hurt you.
I'm not worried about that. I just didn't know he was that close to me.
She's gonna run to here and say, "See you later, suckers." And just lodge a fireball at those two that are sitting in the corner. One of them, critical success, the other fails.
I thought that was directed at us.
She
was looking past all of you to the Grave Knights, launched a fireball past all of you, and blasts one of them for 31 damage. And to her turn, brings it to Tal'Darris, who says, "Aha! Flames of Justice!" And he runs over to here. He's going to cast Fist once more. Oh, not it, not that. This. Nat 2 still hits.
I love that he completely misinterprets. She's like, flames of vengeance, not justice. Come on.
He doesn't understand that. He's kind of dumb.
Yeah. He's a little dumb.
That misses. Okay, with Silka, quick leap to put herself here to make this off guard. This probably won't last very long, this fight here.
Oh, I don't doubt that.
Off guard.
She's a powerhouse.
And Silka's great. I like her a lot. She's going to flurry of blows. Stab. Hit. Second strike. Doing 20 damage. Second strike of the flurry. Oh, that was almost a nat 20, but no, still a hit. Some more damage. And then she gets one last one at her penalty. Ooh, that might still hit to the natural 19 on her penalty. Good job with Silka. Laying on the damage. It looks pretty hurt. That brings it. Oh, that counts as Danny's. That's its turn. The Grave Knight says, "Oh, the escaped prisoner. We must stop them." As he swings his oh my god, Nat critical miss, clonk with his short sword on Tal'Darris.
Oh, rats!
It would suck if they did this, but it would have been so funny if they both were like, "Get the rat! Ignore everything else. Go for the rat."
All misses. Reese, you're up.
Okay, so Reese is going to just like pop around the corner and be like, "Oh, god damn it, not another one of these assholes." And goes and does a flaming arrow at the Axiomite.
Which one? The hurt one or the...
The hurt one.
Okay. Okay, that's a hit.
Okay, I'm gonna just do another one. So if I all can right. just put all the damage, I will.
Let's see. Two of them. Okay, so just hold shift, and it'll count as a crit.
Okay, shift.
If you can, with the cat on you like that.
Yeah, well, everybody can't see as my cat, as per usual, is very much on me right now.
Like a violin, like literally across the chest.
Yeah, he's... Ooh.
You obliterate this thing with that nasty arrow. Well, you overkill it by 39. It by a lot, yeah. So you still have the rest of your flurry and then two actions.
And I think what I'm going to do is go aim at number two.
Mm-hmm.
And just be like, "Yeah, no, that was funny. I'm going to do that again."
Maybe. Yep, that hits. 42.
And then do I do one more roll?
Yeah, one more at your lowest.
Stop it.
So, but you got one.
He just does two in a row to be like, "All right, maybe I can get another cute hit." Okay, that's not bad.
Yeah, 35, pretty good. Okay, end of your turn. Brings to Hamokai. Hamokai can't really fit in there, so they're just going to pass their turn. Alzem, though, can definitely help. Jumping up onto the table and making this guy off guard, who he thinks is his former ally. Oh, what are you doing, brother? I hate traitors. come on, give Fantasy Grounds. Off guard. Baby. I think I got it. Okay, great. Got it. Alzin's gonna swing. Hit! Wonderful. This guy's gonna die very, very quickly. One more swing from Alzum. Maybe? Yes. Another hit. Brings it to Danny. Zavid is on deck.
So, do I see Khan? Because unfortunately I can't move my my thing around too much right now.
Oh, I see. You would have seen her south of you from here, yeah. If you can zoom out, you'd be able to see her.
That's the problem. I can't. It's not letting me zoom out or zoom in or move anything around, so I'm literally stuck.
Ugh.
So you just have to move my PC, if that's okay, please.
Yeah, we can do that.
Thank you.
I will send you a screenshot of what you're looking at.
Cool. So I assume that Dan still has, if I give him a move action or whatever, he'll do his thing?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that means I still have a something to do, correct?
That's right.
Okay, let us heal Khan.
I was going to say Khan needs a heal real bad.
Let's go 7th level Soothe.
Perfect.
If you could drop that on her, because I can't see her.
Oh, yeah, I can do that. Danny's character sheet, actions tab. You have a million spells, so it's taking a second to load. My Fantasy Grounds, don't freeze up on me. You can do this, buddy. Okay. Soothe. 7th level. Got it. Found it. Here you go, Khan. You get 63 healing back from Danny's Soothe.
Ma'am, stop it. Sorry.
That is the end of your turn, Danny. Bring it to Zavid.
Oh, does Dan Khan do anything?
Oh, Dan. Yeah. Dan is going to move over and attack as well. There's a million things on this combat tracker. There's Dan. That's a hit. Natural 14 for a 38 on the Grave Knight. Does some damage. 32 damage. It's not quite dead yet, but it's looking bad. Zavid, you're up. If he is there.
If he's not, I think he's feeding the baby.
I think he might be. So I think this is very close to the end of the fight. So I'm going to have him move in and telekinetic projectile. You think that seems about right?
Yeah.
Not waste a spell slot?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's just go with the Zavid standard. At 2, that's a miss. So unfortunately, that is the end of Zavid's turn. I think that brings us to the top of the round. Khan, whoops. I passed you. Khan, you're up.
All right. Let's just slide in there. Can Khan, slide under the table past him?
Yes, you could probably, assurance that with your acrobatics.
Yeah. So Alzum just sees Khan, dive between the chairs, and there's, scritchy scratch of claws on tile, and then she emerges. Ha ha!
Ugh! Acrobatics!
And a rat!
Acrobatic rats.
Ugh, amazing rat tricks.
That's a hit, yep.
That's a hit. Let's go.
Lots of dice. Yep, it's looking real bad.
Let's try this again.
It's a hit.
Yes.
38, yep. This might do it. That does it. All right, Khan. Yes. How do you take this thing out?
Can she do Yeah, I want her to, like, scurry up his armor, and then just, like, repeatedly stab him in the face.
As he falls down, hits the ground, the last word you hear is a gurgling. Well done, you're out of initiative.
Yippee!
The Fae, Anko, and the Ya, the two Grave Knights, are defeated. And standing behind you, now that we're out of combat, I can share this image, is a beautiful yellow-skinned devil with long, curly black horns, off of which hang long scrolls, all written in Infernal, that seem to twirl and dance as she moves. She wears a long but somewhat revealing red robe with a yellow sash in the middle. She has long black hair, and she looks to all of you and says,
"Thank you very much for assisting me. I thought that they had the best of me, for sure."
Well, you find allies in dark places, and sometimes it's the darkness that they make.
Isn't that for certain? My name is Flagomi.
Pleasure. We are Lux Et Umbra, and we have our friends with us as well.
It is lovely to meet you. Well, I must thank you for getting me out of that backwards contract with Anko, that Fae. If you ever have need of me, just remember my name.
And with that, she disappears into a wisp of fire. And as she casts plane shift and disappears.
I go over to Dan. Who was she?
She said her name was Flagomi. She appeared to be a contract devil.
Was that? I feel like those are the kinds that I was reading about this book, and I think they like you sell their soul. You sell their soul to them, or something, right?
That it could be one of the costs. They can take many things. It would appear she was in a more one-sided deal that you must have gotten her out of. Quite a powerful friend, if need.
And we might.
Thanks, Dan.
Of course. Call upon me whenever you need.
The barbed devil disappears from sight. All right, so there is a door to the northwest of you, and a double door to the southeast, and then a single door to the west that just goes to a room you've already been.
Do we want to wait a couple minutes for Shane to get back?
Sure, we can take a quick intermission. Yeah, how about that? Yeah. We'll take a quick 5, 10, 15 intermission and hope everyone will join us then. We'll see you shortly. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you. Thank you.
1.
Welcome back, everybody. We are back from our intermission. It's slightly longer than usual, but yeah, we all needed it. So, when last we left off, Lux Et Umbra had burst into a conference room in the Lost Silhouette and interrupted a contract devil named Flagomi from being accosted by two Axiomite Grave Knights and a large fae trying to collect on a one-sided deal. But this is where we left off. She has since disappeared, and all is quiet once more.
I go to Khan. Khan, you took a rough beating during that fight. Are you all right?
You know, I meant well, and there's like blood all over her fur.
Yours.
That's
yeah,
nothing
just
new.
So much more noticeable because her fur is white now.
I can lock it off. I still have a soothe spell I could use to bring you back up before we enter the next room.
You want to?
Well,
say
you know,
that?
if it's not a bottle, if it's, you know.
You know, when I take my cursor and hover it over your icon, it says you have heavy wounds. So I just want to make sure that we're good to go.
Yeah. The council doesn't lie, you know.
So I'll cast soothe. I know you've got it, unless you want to use it now, Danny. Like you can.
I was gonna use healing hands if you want to use yours.
I'll keep mine on my back pocket if we don't have another option.
Yeah, her lay on hands is a focus point. So let me find
that's better.
That.
Yeah.
Just so you don't have to waste your spell, just in case.
Yep, there it is. I found it.
So you're unlimited. Who knows how many spells.
All right.
There you go, 32 for Khan.
Still wounded, but not as bad. I have my scalpel and surgeon mask.
Do you want some risky surgery to help stitch up those wounds?
You don't even do risky surgery anymore, right? You were at the point where it's above risky, right?
Well, essentially, I can treat wounds, but I don't even need to make a check because I always pass. So I would just deal some damage and do the max amount of healing every time.
This is
sort of the...
What level is your medicine at?
Expert, I think.
Okay, so if it's 4d8 plus 10 healing.
Yeah. All right, so here's my roll. This is, by the way, you have to consent. I'm rolling prematurely here.
Yeah. No, Khan is totally fine with it. Like, she kind of bends over and then goes like, and like blood starts falling on the floor.
I don't have
like,
to
ask. Maybe one of the wounds opened up.
Yeah, otherwise I was going to give a look to Wasilka and Alzheimer and be like, hold her on the table. And then I pull up my tools.
But yeah,
Don't worry, I suture things up all the time. You don't need anesthetic, do you? I didn't bring any with me.
4d8 plus 10.
4d8, so first take this.
Take
damage.
This!
Oh, yeah.
And then... you are going to heal. Oh, wow. Not so great.
20.
23.
Hey,
yeah, 20 total.
Khan is at 100 wounds.
All right. Well, you're wounded, but I mean, like, at least you've got stitches.
Yeah.
You're not going to pop a gut.
That's all I can do in the 10 minutes that we've had to sort of catch our breath. But I've noticed this room here. There was a door to it in the room north, and I think I remember... A wall that kind of angled. There must be a room inside here. Something important.
Ooh, let's check it.
Let's see what it is.
It is?
Get your guns out.
Who is attempting to open it?
I will. Fuck it. Let's do it.
It appears to be locked.
Oh, shit! Oh, it looks like we're gonna have to turn around and go somewhere else.
Nothing you can do.
Yeah, I know. Wait.
Like, Reese is just gonna try to, like, take the initiative and be like, you know what? No. Hold on. Let me see if I could do it. Khan, if I can't do it, then you can try, but I don't want you to hurt yourself.
Yeah, step right up.
It's
thievery. 36.
Okay. Public?
36.
Watch you succeed, and then Hamal Kai comes in and goes like, you know, I've got this key you might need.
Yeah, right? I just like...
That's a critical failure.
Yeah,
your lockpick breaks.
I go and twist and like, oh, fuck. Okay, maybe these are weaker. Okay, all right. And he takes all the bits out.
Yeah, Con, go ahead. 36.
Right. I do like
she takes out like shot. A lockpick from behind her ear. And then just...
I imagine Con just has a really long pinky nail that she can do.
Yeah, right?
And you are so able to open the door.
People think she does drugs, but it's not drugs.
It's, everyone thinks it's a coke nail, yeah.
This is not the coke she's nail. That fast.
Several catwalks crisscross a deep pit in this frigid room. Along the walls are six vertical grooves, each fitted with a looped chain, and each one controlled by a different nearby pulley mechanism. Dangling from these chains are columns of living bodies, some emaciated and others painfully bloated.
Are you guys alive in here?
Some of us. Are you our saviors? I have great riches. I can give you riches.
You're already bargaining, man. You must be desperate. All right, let's lift them out of here.
Yeah.
Another starts being like, oh, power, we can give you secrets, anything. Every one of them is immediately, like as you said, bargaining, trying to get you to get them out of here.
Can I make some checks on these people?
Perception check.
I want to just get a vibe of like, why are they... is it out of desperation, or is there like a more nefarious reason? Like they should be in prison because they're like bad in some way, maybe. I don't know.
Reese, you see immediately that most of them are dressed like you were when you were disguised as Petitioner Aeopol.
Okay.
They all have like, they're all kind of raggedy because they've been in here a while, but they all appear to be like petitioners.
Okay. Reese just looks over to Zvi and like, these are more petitioners.
Oh, got it. The gnome's like, I soiled myself, but I'll still pay you handsomely for getting me out of here.
Bury that.
Once when I change these pantaloons.
My fine silks have been ruined forever, but I have a
I soiled them! Soiled it!
Soiled them! Shut
soil
up!
That.
Bring up the gnome. Thank you! It's like covered in shit. Like,
At Zvid, as you, I'm going to place you in a different spot.
Okay.
Over to here. You're kind of, each of you are helping a different area, getting these people off of these hooks, and they're all thank you. Oh, thank you so much. And they're running out, trying to escape. And as you're over here on the western wall, you're working this pulley system, and down comes a red tiefling woman. And she looks to you, and you can see the eyes darting back and forth. Skin is somewhat of a suspicious way, but she doesn't say anything at all to you.
All right, give me a second because I heard something drop in the kitchen.
Yes, go ahead.
All right, I put a relatable GIF in the Discord, is just kind of like how I see this happening.
Yeah, pretty much.
It's a Gravity Falls gnome barfing rainbows.
But yes, yeah, you... So all of Reese, you're helping get these people off of the walls. Con, what are you doing in here?
She's doing the same. It's a bit harder because she can't reach as far, but she can like, she like, oh, Bronwyn,
oh,
it's baby. The bibs. Eh?
She just finished her bottle and she dropped it on the floor to let me know she was done.
Hey, that's how you know.
That's a good signal.
Yeah.
So there's a red tiefling lady who's looking at her.
Kind of. Switchy eyes, suspicious.
How long does it seem like she's been in here?
Not long. Maybe a week or two, maybe. Not as long as some.
Wearing fine garments, or is she dressed differently?
Yeah, pretty fine. Same stuff.
Is this maybe the original body of our pal who got body swapped?
Throw me a perception con, because you didn't do that.
Gotcha.
Yeah?
Thank you for pointing that out. That was so good.
Yes.
I was like, something about her sounds familiar. Hmm.
Yeah, you get the sense, Con, that might be the Alzum's body. And it's probably not talking because it's a Yithian, which is, it doesn't speak common. It's like an alien, essentially.
Oh, what can I try different languages and talking to them?
And can Reese help aid that?
Of all my languages, you might have to look through them. I'll try each one. Hailing signal, like hello, bonjour. Hola. Reese
rolled a 42. Aklo.
Aklo. All right.
Yeah, and
Reese knows Aklo. So once I get to Aklo and it like recognizes my language, I'm going to say,
I see you are a Yithian in disguise, are you not?
How did you know?
It's like you can hear it in your head.
All right. Listen. Your original body took a beating. I don't know if it's still alive, but we did find it. Maybe it can be resuscitated if you'd like to return to the body that you remember and know and be free of this place. But we need this body back because we have the one that used to reside in it still. Or you can switch with their new body. They're in an undead axiomite. That's right.
That was the sound of Alzim coming into the room hearing this conversation.
let's be civil about this and figure out the way that will work for everybody. I'm sure we can figure this out.
Yeah, I think I can do that. It just seems okay. I'll switch over. Please just don't kill me.
Oh, of course not.
I mean, I'm curious, how did you get to this position? What happened?
Well, they're just trying to keep petitioners here. They put secrets on our bodies, and, well, any secrets they don't want, they get tattooed on us, and they put us in that maze to get killed by the demons.
That's brutal.
So you were a Yithian petitioner?
I was, but these fiends kidnapped me.
I see. I do have a ritual to raise the dead, like the real way. I could bring his body back, it would just take an hour. We don't have an hour right now, but if you want to hold off, I can get you back into your regular body.
Oh, sure. If you'd like to switch me to this grave knight, that's fine for now. I just want off of this hook.
I'll let them off the hook if they're... I imagine I'm already taking them off. You're off the hook for now. We'll do whatever medical stuff to stabilize and heal people and make sure that they're not, like, openly bleeding out and have, like, necrosis in their wounds and shit. And then I'll go to Alzim and be like, so, we've got your body back. You should probably go back to your body, and I know it's not as strong as the one you're in, but trust me, you don't want to be stuck in a body you don't like. It sounds cool at first until you wake up one day and you're like, this sucks. I don't want to be this anymore.
I think you're right. Let's do this.
And the Yithian within the tiefling puts her hand up and places it on the Grave Knight's head. And you see a flash and then they blink. And the tiefling, who I, for some reason, can't... Why can't I share that image? That's very annoying.
She's invisible all the time.
I can put her on the... There. Can I share this image? Probably not. No, that's annoying. But she is a beautiful red-skinned tiefling woman with goat horns that curl back on the back of her head. And she looks up to you and says,
I'm me again. Thank you all.
It's like, and why do you have the goat horns? Well, my father was an ambassador.
Oh my god, stop it.
That was amazing. That was actually pretty funny.
I was going to make a joke. Man, I hate when my aliens are getting transgender surgery in prison.
Oh no. Oh lordy. But you were able to get all of these... peoples out of here. There we go, the flesh locker. Could just delete that. You're able to get them all out of here, and you do have the new Alzim and the old one within the same body up here with you.
Well, I'll go. Right now, we can't fetch the Yithian's corpse, but we can... I can use a ritual to bring it back. Mm-hmm. Unless it's easier for, like, an aberration to just, like, I don't know, get themselves back to life in a different way. Like, oh, I just need to dream about it on a blood moon, and then it'll just come back to life, or something. I don't know. They might have different rules, but...
They might. I don't actually know.
I can ritual it at our convenience.
Indeed. So, what do you do from here?
We need to find that putty. So...
Find the what? I just didn't understand.
The putty, the alchemist...
Oh, yeah, alchemist stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're looking for a lab, an alchemy lab. Any of you know where that might be?
Yes, just a bit to the south. There's a large one and then another one to the directly east of here, I think, says the Grave Knight. I'm just going to call them the Grave Knight now.
Yeah. All right. Everybody, let's get out. It's cold in here. Let's all go into the conference room. Yes. Everybody take a seat at the table. Relax. We're clearing this compound out in the name of Norgorber. But also because we don't like the people that took it over, so it's also a personal matter. But luckily, we have Hamalkai here, who has been cleansed of the corruption that they had. They can sort of see to you and make sure you all are doing okay. So basically, all of these like petitioners can just like chill out while we figure this situation.
Yeah, I think Hamalkai will be dealing with the petitioners. That's a good thing for them to be doing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Keeps them out of trouble too.
Very much so.
Let's go. I mean, we got these double doors of the south here. I'm thinking.
Yeah, let's go.
You want that? Let's, okay. Not locked.
Like, you know, like Munchkin, we kick down the door.
Not locked, so you're able to open it. It opens up into a fairly large hallway. like that, and then it continues to the south.
See.
Here.
A lot of doors, a lot of rooms.
A lot of rooms to pick from. There you go. Quite a few doors. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 choices.
I want to circle back this way, but I don't want to split up too much.
Sure.
Aldaris, can you follow me, big...
Of course, I will be your backup.
Yeah. We should do pairs. Let's split the party. That can't go wrong.
Yeah. That can little never go wrong.
Go well.
Never.
Yeah. So yeah, who's going with whom?
I'm gonna go with Elzum because she needs somebody who is not squishy.
True. Okay.
Who are my options?
Khan or Wasilka? Or I guess you could take both.
I'll go with Khan and Wasilka.
Okay. So I'm gonna go with Zavid and Tal'Darris first. You open up this door, which is not locked. And,
that looks like an alchemy lab.
A little bit. This laboratory provides enough space for 6 technicians, and it has 2 broad copper awnings over the marked areas to vent dangerous fumes. And what you see are 2 large spider-like constructs. That roll me a crafting check in the tower to see if you have any idea what these are. They appear to be like large spiders that have a bandolier of different potions around them, much like Khan sometimes wears. Oh, sure. You've heard of these. These are called Karumzeks. They are not golems, but they're constructs that do alchemy. So these are like mindless automatons that are in here making potions.
Can you open up the map again? I think I lost it.
Oh, yeah, sure. Sure. There you go.
So as long as I don't disturb them from their work, they'll just continue doing it, right?
Seems that way. Okay, they haven't attacked you yet, and you've walked in the room.
I'm not gonna mess with them, since I know that they have like a directive, and they I think would only defend themselves if I fuck with the alchemy stuff while they're still doing stuff with it. So I'm gonna just walk back out.
Give me a perception check before you leave.
Oh yeah, sure. I'll take a one. So that's a good idea.
Yeah, you can walk around just as long as you don't mess with things.
I exit as if it were just like, oh, sorry, like a bathroom.
Ooh, okay. you notice that they are all making... They seem to be working on one thing, and they're reading from a single book in the center of the room that is kind of open.
I would like... to get some input
from
Hamalkai. Oh. Okay. I want to know if Hamalkai knows, like, these things, are they Norgorber things? Because this is Norgorber's alchemy lab, right? So, like, how do we change their directive or figure out what their current directive is, what they're making?
Well, I believe that they're making serums in there. I'm not entirely sure. I'm not much of an alchemist myself, but I know we've been interrogating a lot of people lately. It might be maybe something for that, a pain elixir, perhaps?
Or maybe a ghoul fever concentrate.
Oh, maybe.
Hmm.
There's a lot of stuff. I'm just wondering, they're going to continue working on this thing, but maybe we can get them to pause their work. I think we need like a code word or command word. Maybe I tell everybody, keep your eyes out for any sort of like office or something that might have like a password or passphrase to like get them to change their work or stop so we can use the lab. But yeah, that's what I would do in this.
Okay. Then I'm going to jump over to Reese. What do you do? Where you go?
So Reese is going to go over to this door where he is, and he's going to turn to Aslam and go, I'm going to be invisible for just a second. You stay out of the doorway, just in case anybody comes around. So sure. Let me work, and I'll let you know when you can come in. So
all
he
right.
goes to this door and opens it.
It is open. A wide stone bowl filled with wood shaving sits in the corner of this rectangular room, and an empty chamber pot sits nearby. A tall mirror hangs along the south wall, and standing in front of the mirror is a bizarre creature about the size of a sheep. It has four legs, and its body appears to be in the shape of a massive humanoid brain.
What kind of roll can I make to try to see what this guy is?
That would be Arcana or Occultism in the tower.
All right, Occultism or Arcana. Let's see, that's 23, and that is 23. Okay, I'm going to go
same.
Occultism.
Cool. Oh, sure. You've heard of these. This is an intellect devourer. It's a walking brain. They can talk, but they're telepathic. And you know from that, you've heard that you can almost store memories in them, almost like a hard drive, for lack of a better word.
He closes the door very quietly and gently, and he just goes, there's an intellect devourer in there. That's fun. All right. And he just is like, all right, I'm gonna go to the other door. Stand clear.
All right, so you open that one. Actually, that one's locked, so give me a thievery if you want to unlock it.
Yeah, I'm gonna
you're looking for 36 publicly.
Time for redemption, let's do it.
Right. Oh yeah. There it is. Nice. Click it open. You redeem yourself, Reese.
Not a broken lock.
Nope. You walk into this room and you see that it is filthy. There's a brittle crust of mucus nearly 6 inches thick along the floor of this whole room. It's fetid and nasty.
Is it Zavid's room?
And nature, perhaps? You're not quite. You were one off.
Oh, shit. Okay. Reese just goes, okay, that's nasty. Gross.
It's just nasty. You're not sure.
All right. He goes around, sees Khan, just goes, okay, so I think there's something Zavid might like. There's an intellect devourer in the other room, and I know you can take its memories. I think he might know something because he made Alkana like an entity, right? And he's like, can you do that? Can he go through their memories?
I mean, it wouldn't surprise me. And Savit loves fucked up creatures.
He
collects them.
Honestly, it's kind of cute. It's just a little guy.
What are they talking about?
There's an intellect devourer.
Do I know what that is?
Roll a public occultism. You're looking for a 36. You do. You've heard of him.
I know exactly what that is. I read about it yesterday.
Nice.
I know we could search their memories. Is there anything you can do with that so we can get more information?
Yes. That's what. Okay.
Danny can mind read.
What magic? Detect thoughts, right?
Danny has detect thoughts.
Danny would do that.
Danny do what?
She has detect thoughts.
Hey, Danny. Oh. I know normally you'd like to detect thoughts on, like, a hot guy or something, but there's, like, a brain with legs that we need you to, like, look into their mind and see if they have, like, a passcode or any sort of interesting information.
And when you go, I can make you super stealthy so you won't be seen. You know it.
That's fine. But Savine, I'd like to think that I'm a little more useful than just thinking about hot guys. I mean,
no,
hot guys
you
is
are,
a part
you are
of my
useful
thing.
For that. I'm just saying, when you saw that inevitable back there, I think we talked to you and your eyes never left him. You were like, your eyes were constantly looking at the body of this guy. And
he was built like a brick house.
I mean, his mother probably was a brick house.
Fuck, that's good.
Take a hero point, Zavid.
Oh, thank you. All that to say, I don't think it's a bad thing, and look, this thing might have information, and none of us are going to be able to get into its brain.
That is good.
I'll get into its brain. I'm going to cast detect thoughts.
Or mind reading. There it is.
Pathfinder.
Is Danny up there?
Okay. I dragged her token down because I don't know.
Okay, perfect. Thank you.
And you're making her stealthy?
Yeah, Reese is going to do the, not warp step, the warden step.
Okay.
So she is very, very non-detectable.
Sure. Give me a stealth in the tower then, Reese.
Oh, yep. They'll back off.
Okay. So you begin to cast this spell. And let's see. Okay. You perceive some vague surface thoughts at first. Let me see. Yeah, all right. And at first, it's kind of just noise. You hear a bunch of, it's like when being in a crowd. You hear a lot of different voices all talking over each other. And as you're kind of wading through it, it critically failed its save. So you're able to kind of wade through, filter out the noise. And you're realizing that all of it is just quick little things like, I never achieved as much as my father. Oh, I'll never be as good as my sister. You know, little quick thoughts like that that are all from different voices, different genders, ages, ancestries. It's very confusing to try and pick out. But as you're digging through, you do hear you do get an image in your mind of an area on the back of these machines that you can turn them off into like a stasis mode.
I have a question to ask. And tell me if this would be possible. Would I be able to, like, as I'm doing this, like, message, whether it be Zavid or Reese or whomever, possibly both?
I'm standing right next to you.
Yeah.
Okay. But be able to, like, almost pass along the information that I'm getting?
Yeah.
Oh, most definitely. Yeah, you could tell Reese or Khan or whoever sneaky person that there is, like, a shutoff. Standby mode sort of lever.
Awesome. Do you know where?
Do I know where?
It's like in the back of the neck. Okay. So someone would have to get in there sneaky and climb up on them.
Okay.
Maybe someone the size of a rat who could sneak in through the wall at times.
Reese just goes over to Khan, just like, oh my god, they have an off switch literally in the back of their necks.
Say no mill. Puff of smoke, and it's a rat.
So you are able to climb through the dark gray walls at your leisure now, because the Hamakai's tubes are everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And give me two stealths in the tower, because it's advantage.
I love that. Say less. Poof.
In the tower?
Yep. Yes, please. Two of them.
Cool.
Okay, you can move around. I know your results.
All right. Yeah, she moves around. She kind of like peeks out a little bit, and they're very focused on their work. So she hops out here. It kind of, I like to think that it's a sequence like in Ratatouille when Remy is like going through the kitchen and trying to escape.
Yes.
But yeah, so she, you know, she scampers up onto this desk counter.
Alchemy lab here, table.
Yeah, it's going to try to jump onto the bandolier and then onto their neck.
Okay, and you give me a crafting check publicly. Because cool. You see it, let's just see if you can figure out how it works, though.
Yeah.
36, that is enough. I was looking, that 36 is the DC.
Nice.
So, yeah, you're able to get this one disconnected.
This release valve that is perfectly rat hand sized.
Exact. I like to imagine that you can selectively churn back into Khan. Like you can make your one hand just huge and manipulate it and then whoosh, back to a rat hand.
You know, I used to do that in World of Darkness, the Werewolf the Apocalypse. Yeah. You could have partial transformations. So like I played a werewolf that just would rob jewelry stores by transforming only his head. So it looked like a mask or a Halloween mask. And then he would transform just his like fingerprints away, so they were furry, so that he wouldn't leave fingerprints anywhere.
Oh my god, that's hilarious.
He had little things like that, and then one of the guy was playing a detective was chasing him, so he transformed his arms and like climbed up a wall. The guy's like, "Oh, okay."
Well,
fun times. Fun times. There should be something like that for Khan. Khan should be able to do that.
Oh, love that.
Same. So Khan, yes, you were able to easily get that one kill or taken out. It is, let's see, that's number one. Yeah, so it is non-functional. So if you are going to the other one, I'm going to need another advantage stealth check.
You got it. She's like bobbing and weaving between beakers. She like jumps over a potion that's boiling. Cinches the end of her tail.
Little Rat Con is in like an all black jumpsuit with like night vision goggles and like a yeah.
You under the ceiling and a run. It's good you had advantage because you rolled a nat one on one of those. So you do succeed. You're able to get to the other one. So give me another crafting publicly. You're looking for a 36 or a 40. I mean,
40 easy.
Oh my
easy.
What do you do? What do you do to it? What do you do to it?
Rough it up.
No, I don't want to rough it up. Oh. I want it to be my friend.
Invite it to lunch.
How can Khan reprogram it, perhaps?
Maybe. Yeah, with a 52 on a nat 20, yeah, you can probably reprogram it to do something basic. What are you trying to get it to do?
I want it to change what it's making. I want it to make healing potions for all the petitioners.
I would say that's easy enough for you to get it to do. So I'll change it to friendly, and yeah, it's going to start creating potions. The other one, however, is broken.
Gotcha. That's fine.
Yeah. But there, Zavid, I don't remember if you told Khan about the book that was in there.
I would have relayed everything. Like, we're looking for a passcode, and they're using a book to create stuff. Once it's safe to go in there, I'd go back in and, like, point it out.
Okay.
Yeah, she'll turn back into regular Khan and kind of wave everybody in. She'll be like, "Oh, don't worry about that one. It's my friend now."
I didn't mean to do that.
I'm not surprised in the least.
What you find is an alchemy formula for a potion that you did not know existed. You'd heard rumors of it, but apparently it might be real. And there's one bottle made. Yukon can now make major truth potions.
Oh shit.
And I've put one in your inventory.
Immediately drinks it. Tastes like shit. Wow, it works.
Oh, and Danny, before I forget, because I could easily forget this, there's one other thought you get from the intellect devourer, and it's loose brick mirror. Or loose brick behind mirror.
Something about a loose brick behind mirror, guys.
Mirror that's in that room where the intellect of art.
Am I so super stealthy?
Maybe we should check it out.
Reese is gonna go back to...
Khan search stuff to like cleanse or get rid of the chaos language on that guy. Like we're looking for alchemy stuff.
Yeah.
I'll aid with a crafting check, and then Reese and Danny, and if you guys want to check out the mirror.
Yeah, I'm gonna go invisible.
Sure. Okay, great. Invisible. Nice. So Reese, you pull that aside, and behind a loose brick, you see a single wooden wand.
He takes the wand out, puts the brick back in, sneaks out, and then goes back. He's like, "So I found a wand."
Zavid, with that crafting check, you can see that this entire laboratory is dedicated to making one thing. Truth potion.
But not
anything that would be helpful with Pavarish.
Okay.
All right. Anyone who wants to give an arcana in the tower can look at that wand.
Yeah, I'll give an arcana.
Reese is gonna attempt to see if he knows this.
Con pipette comes out of your cowl and says, "Oh, this is a particularly rare item. This is a wand of disguised self of 9th rank.
Ooh. Oh!
Once a day, you could use it to disguise yourself as any humanoid, even a specific person, with their voice, if you've heard it."
Wait, what if we... The petitioner.
So you could... Let me get this right. The power of this stuff. You wake up one day, you have a nasty zit, you can make it yourself, but without the acne?
Yes, theoretically.
No skincare routine necessary. Just use the wand.
Never again.
I don't have to wash my hair. I could just do whatever I want and just be like, poof, yeah, I washed my hair this morning. Perfect.
Reese
wonderful.
Would smell it and you're like, I somehow doubt them.
Shit, you're right.
Like every chance Danny gets, she'll prestidigitate Zavid just because.
Because you never know. Yeah. You never know.
Yeah, you never know how long it's been.
Never know. Who wants that wand?
I think collectively as a group it would be useful, but only once a day used?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I think Khan is good because she can usually get into places easily enough, either to sneak or turn into
Danny.
A rat, so she doesn't need to disguise herself.
Give it
herself.
To Danny? Okay.
Yeah.
Because she's kind of famous and kidnappable.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, good point.
Eminently good point. Kidnappable.
Eminently kidnappable.
Yeah.
So, I've put the Wand of Disguised Self 9th rank in your inventory there, Danny. Yeah, the Karumzik just goes back to work trying to modify this lab into healing potions. There's three more rooms left in this floor.
Wanna continue next time to look at it?
We could, if you want to get to the into one, we can do that and then kick it off to next time.
Yeah.
So, there is a room to the far west, the very left near the entrance that you didn't go into, and there's another one to the east of the big hallway you just opened, and another one to the north of the hall. That Zavid would have realized as a secret door, because he has true seeing on. I forgot to mention that. There is a secret door there.
Oh, by the way, there's something over here.
Oh. I look through.
It's a short hallway that has another hallucinatory door. So let me, probably another hallucinatory wall. And you can see through that there is a circular garden filled with plants on the other side. Mm. You'd have to go in to get more than that.
I would like to wait to do that. Also, it's kind of stinky in there. Let's look at these other rooms first.
Yeah, Reese goes down to the bottom one.
Bottom
one. We're all there. We're all squared up.
Yeah.
Okay, so everyone's basically down there. So this opens up to here. This laboratory hosts a variety of experiments in chemistry, flesh grafting, and alchemical botany. Its numerous workbenches can accommodate up to 10 researchers, and its shelves hold a wealth of scientific texts and logbooks. The ceiling is 20 feet high, with two entrances flank a 15-tall platform. Oh, and two more of those Karumzik alchemists, the spider things, are in here. They're just not on the map right this second. I'm adding them now. But again, there's two more here, and they're right there.
Okay.
You would have seen that before walking in.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Andre, excuse me. okay.
Well, we know how to turn them off, so
Mm-hmm. But yeah, if you want, we can. This would be a fine place to stop. We can pick up next time.
Yeah.
I don't know if we're on next week. We might be. We'll figure it out. Play it by ear. We'll let everyone know on Twitter. I hope everyone will join us, and we'll see what's up with this weird slime mold thing in this strange laboratory, and finish up the Lost Silhouette Dungeon. Hope everyone will join us. Bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.